good to know that God is able. It's good to know that we serve an able God. Amen. You have a lot of people out here who are serving all types of God. Amen. They're serving gods that some people are serving statues. They serve cabbage hands. They serve all these gods, but we know that we serve a true living God who is able to do anything but fail. I don't know, but it feels good to be here in the house of the Lord one more time. I thank God for St. Paul, First Baptist Church, for inviting me and allowing me to come in and be with y'all once again. Truly, I don't take it for granted at all. Amen. Every chance that I get to share forth the good news, I'm just overly joyed and overwhelmed, amen, for the opportunity to speak and share God's word. I would also like to just, and acknowledge, of course, I have to mention Pastor Richard Benjamin Haynes, the pastor at Salem Missionary Baptist Church, where I serve, who has allowed me graciously to come and share with you all on today. Amen. I think I've said this before, you know, I'm one that believes in following leadership and obeying those who have authority over you. So if Pastor Haynes, for some reason, would have said, no, you can't go up there, or I need you here today, then unfortunately, I probably wouldn't have been here this morning. So I thank God that he allowed me to come and the Lord touched his heart. I also would like to acknowledge my mother in her absence, Reverend Pastor Gail Bush, who pastors Open Arms Ministries down in Lawrenceville, Georgia. And I'd like to also acknowledge my children once again. Well, three out of the four are here. Amen. Three out of the four. Thank God for them being here on today. And of course, I can't forget about my wife over there. I want to be able to go home and lay my head down. So, amen. And of course, I acknowledge all of the ministers of this house. Amen. It's awesome to see you all. And Mr. Brooks, the first time I meet him on today, I told him I like that tie he had on. Amen. And to all the deacons, the trustees, and everyone, it's good to be here in the house of the Lord. Amen. So I'm not going to be before you long, if the Lord says the same. But I do know that there is a word from God on today. Amen. Truly, we are living in a day and time where I often say that we're living in uncertain times. What I mean by that is we never know really what to expect when we turn on the television and when we get out of bed and go to work and do things. We don't really know what's going to confront us out there. The only thing that we do know, amen, is that our Father in heaven is watching over us. Amen. We do know that. Amen. And we do know that no matter what the enemy may try to do, it's not much that he can do because God has his head of protection around us all. Amen. So it is my God's will that we be encouraged and know that no matter what's going on in this world today, we are going to make it. Amen. With Jesus. So those of you that have your Bible, like I said, I'm not going to be before you long, but we're going to go to Romans, a very familiar book in the Bible. Romans 8, and we're going to read verses 18 through 21. That's Romans 8, verses 18 through 21. Amen. They have it up on the screen. Amen. And it simply says, "For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. For the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him whom hath subjected the same in hope. Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God." And I just want to lift up verse 18, if you don't mind, where it simply says, "For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Now, Father God, as we get ready to bring forth your word, oh God, Lord, we are asking, oh God, that you take me out of myself, oh God. I'm asking that you hop me behind the cross of Calvary, and I'm asking, oh God, that you use me for your glory, oh God, that you may get the glory. Lord, I'm asking that you allow your anointing to rest and fall upon me, oh God, as I speak the word that you have given me to say. And Lord, as you do these things, we won't fail to give you the honor, the glory, and the praise, because it belongs to you. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. You know, God sent me here today just to encourage everyone who can hear my voice to know that no matter what's going on or no matter what you're going through in your life, you need to know that, and I need to know myself, that I'm going to make it. You're going to make it. We're going to make it. Why? Just tell yourself, I'm a survivor.
I'm a survivor.
I'm a survivor. You see, we are living in a day and a time where Satan knows that his time is not long. He knows that Jesus is soon to come. And I believe I stated this on Wednesday night. You know, we've been saying, and I know I've been hearing that Jesus is coming. I've been hearing that for a long time now. I'm 49 years old, and I've been hearing that for a long time. But the older I get and the more that I read God's word, the clearer it appears to me that he is truly, most definitely, positively coming soon, because we see that everything in the scriptures is starting to be fulfilled. Amen. So we know that he is definitely coming soon. And all I can say is we better be ready. Amen. We need to be ready. But as I said before, if you don't remember anything else here that I say, just remember these simple three words. I'm a survivor. But as I said, we're living in a day and time where the enemy knows, and he is working overtime trying to deceive God's people. He is working overtime trying to get us to lose our faith. Yeah. I can almost guarantee right now that if I was to ask everyone in here right now to just stand up and just tell me one thing that you are going through in your life, and I'm not saying tell me something 5 and 10 years ago, I'm talking about tell me one thing that you are going through in your life right now, I'm more than positive that everyone will be able to stand up and tell me something that they are experiencing in their life.
Amen.
You may be saying, well, how do you know this, Brother Preacher? Well, I know it simply because Job 14:1 lets us know that man that is born of woman is of a few days and full of trouble. That scripture alone lets us know that we are going to be experiencing some trials and tribulations in our life. And as we shared even on Wednesday night, another reason that we know this is because of the mistake that took place in that garden. Right. Amen. Because of the one mistake that they made by touching that tree that they were not supposed to touch, we now have to deal with trials and tribulations and storms of life. So I know for a fact, like I said, that we are all dealing with different obstacles in our lives. We are all looking at mountains that would appear to be too hard to climb. But I'm reminded of that old song that they used to sing. Lord, you don't have to move my mountain, but just give me the strength to climb. Why? Because I'm a survivor. Now, Webster's Dictionary says that the word survive means to remain alive, or in existence, or simply to live on.
Amen.
To live on. So my job here today is just to encourage all of my brothers and sisters, including myself, to simply live on.
Amen.
Yes, it seems like our nation is in trouble. It seems like every time you turn on the television and you watch the news, you hear of a police officer that may have shot and possibly killed an unarmed black man in the streets. And if we don't hear about a cop killing black men, then we hear about our own young black boys and men out here in the streets shooting and killing each other for no real good reason at all. There's really no good reason to take anyone's life. I don't care what the situation is, there's really no good reason to take anyone's life. And so when you see these things happening, you have to wonder, what's going on? What's going on? And when I think about what's going on, my mind runs back to Marvin Gaye, who sung that song many, many, many years ago, "What's Going On?" Now, I'm not going to stand here. I hear you trying to say. Now, I'm not going to stand here today and tell you that I have every answer to every situation and problem that you may be dealing with in your life. No, I'm not going to sit here and tell you that. I don't have all the answers. But I do know God does know, and he has all the answers. And there's also one thing that I know for sure, that Satan is working day and night trying to get all of the children of God to lose our desire to survive. I said he is trying to get all of us to lose our desire to survive. And this is one of the reasons that our young men are out here shooting and killing one another. This is one of the reasons you even have some young women out there shooting and stabbing and killing, because they have lost the desire to survive. Well, how do I know this? Another one of my favorite scriptures, John 10:10, the thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. But I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. Tell yourself one more time, I'm a survivor. You see, some of you right now may be dealing with trouble in your marriage. I said you may be dealing with trouble in your marriage. And the devil may be in your ear, and the devil may be saying, well, you know what? If she don't want to act right, trade her in and get another one. Amen. Or the devil may be saying, you know what? If she can't fry that chicken the way grandma used to fry it, get rid of her. Or better yet, if he can't buy me that BMW or Mercedes like my dad bought my mom, I'm going to file for divorce. I'm going to get rid of him. Well, I stop by here right now to encourage you to let the devil know that my marriage will survive. My marriage will survive. Some of us may be dealing with our children or even grandchildren that won't do the right thing. It seems like they always want to do their way. You know, it is amazing that our children, no matter how old we may be, no matter how much life we may have lived, for some reason they seem to think that they know more than what we do. It is the strangest thing to me that they feel that they know more than what we know. And so we see them and they keep making these same mistakes over and over again, and they keep falling down over and over again. And once again, I'm pretty sure the enemy is in your ear just saying, you know what? Just give up on them, children, because they don't want to listen. They're hard. Just give up on them. But God sent me here today, once again, for us to know, to stand and declare that our kids will survive. Our kids will survive. Now, they may not survive on our time, on the time frame that we want them to, but they will survive when God is ready. Amen. Some of us right now may be having issues on their job, where you may have that supervisor who just keeps riding your back. It seems like that supervisor won't keep his knee off your neck. You feel like you can't breathe. No matter what you do, that supervisor's going to always find a way to complain. It would appear that that supervisor was sent from hell just to make your life a living hell. I said the supervisor on your job may have been sent from hell just to make your life a living hell. And I can almost assure you that the enemy is telling some of you, telling some of us, that I've heard it. I've heard him sometimes. Said, you know what? Just go postal on him. Go to job one tomorrow and slap that boss in the face and let that boss know I'm not going to take it no more. You can keep this job. But I want us to know and stand and declare that we got to let the devil know he is a liar. He will not win. We will survive our job. So don't throw in the towel just yet, but just stand and declare that through Jesus Christ, I'm a survivor. You see, some of you right now may be dealing even with some health challenges. And the doctors may have said they have done all that they can do. They have given you all the radiation and all the chemo that they can, and it's not working. Their hands are tied. Well, I want to ask the question, whose report will you believe? Whose report will you believe? You see, it doesn't matter how long you've been dealing with whatever the issue may be. It doesn't matter how long you've been having this sickness or illness in your body. You must know that we serve a God who is more able to do just what he said he would do. Amen. Now, Luke 8:14 backs me up. I mean, 8:43. And it says, and a woman having an issue of blood 12 long years, which had spent all of her living upon physicians, neither could be healed of any. Verse 44, came behind him and touched the border of his garment, and immediately her blood issue had stopped. Verse 45, and Jesus said, who touched me? And when all denied, Peter and they that were with him said, Master, in other words, there are a lot of people out here. There are hundreds and thousands of people out here, and they are all pushing, trying to get to you. And yet you're saying, who touched me? Verse 46, and Jesus said, somebody have touched me, for I perceive that the virtue is gone out of me. And when the woman saw that she could not hide, she came trembling and falling down to him. And she declared unto him before all of the people for what cause she had touched him and how she was healed immediately. And he said unto her, daughter, be of good comfort. Go in peace, for thy faith has made thee whole. So you see, this woman suffered for 12 years. And she tried everything that she could try. She spent all of her money trying to get a healing through doctors. But her healing did not come. But then when she heard that Jesus was coming to town. Now, when I think about this Jesus coming to town, my mind runs back to when I was a child. And whenever December would roll around, we would hear the song, you better watch out, you better not die, you better not cry. I'm telling you why. Because Santa Claus is coming to town. Now, as a grown man, I don't really know what benefit it would do for me for Santa Claus to be coming to town, but I do know something good is going to happen when Jesus comes to your town. Amen. So some of us right now, like I said, are going through situations in our lives, and we may be saying that God has forgotten because there is no change that has taken place. But I wonder, and something that I need us to think about, when we say that we have taken our problems and our situations to Jesus, I wonder how many of us take our situations to him and we say, Lord, whatever it is you have to do, however it is you have to fix it, whatever way it has to be, I just want you to do it. I just want you to heal me. I just want you to deliver me. I just wonder how many of us really approach God like that. Or do we say, you know what, God? I want you to fix me and I want you to heal me, but I want you to do it this way. God, I want you to save my children, but I want you to do it this way. Don't let this happen, but I want you to do it this way. I wonder if that's what we're telling God, because if that's our approach, there lies the problem. You see, we can't take our burdens to God and then tell him how to do it. I said, we can't take our problems to God and then tell him how to fix it. We just have to give it to him and know that he will fix it. They used to sing this old song in my church where I grew up that simply said, the failure's not in God, but it's in me. Amen. Amen. So some of us right now may not have been healed, we may not have been delivered, and we may not have been truly set free because we have not wholeheartedly surrendered and given our problems and burdens to Jesus by declaring that whatever I have to do, whatever you want to do, whatever it's going to take, Lord, heal me, deliver me, restore my mind, restore my body, restore my soul, restore my relationship, restore my marriage, restore my children, restore my living situation, restore my job, restore my finances. Jesus, restore everything that is in my life. Why? For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Why? Because I'm a survivor. I'm a survivor. Psalm 34:19 says, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivereth him out of them all. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivereth him out of them all. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivereth him out of them all. You see, it doesn't say that the Lord only delivered them from some. It didn't say that the Lord would only give you 3 strikes and that's it. No, he will deliver them out of them all. I'm a survivor. In 1978, there was a singer by the name of Gloria Gaynor. Gloria Gaynor. I was about 4 years old, I guess at that time, 4 or 5, somewhere around there. But anyway, Gloria Gaynor sung this song, I Will Survive. And some of you that were into the disco back then, and you know, I'd be in the club or whatever, I'm pretty sure you remember that song, I Will Survive. Amen. I know some of you knew that song. But anyway, she went on to say in this song, at first, I was afraid. I was petrified. And I kept thinking I could never live without you by my side. But then I spent so many nights thinking how you did me wrong. And I grew strong. And I learned how to get along. Now, we're going to stop right there. You see, Sister Gloria Gaynor, she had the right idea. I believe she had the right idea. She even had the right message. However, I believe she was just singing about the wrong person. She was singing about the wrong person. You see, the first line which simply says, at first I was afraid and I was petrified. You see, if Sister Gloria knew the God that I serve and the God that you serve, then she would have known that God has not given us a spirit of fear. She would have already known that, so that line wouldn't make no sense to you, right? Because God hasn't given us a spirit of fear. Psalms 23:4, one of my favorite passages, it says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, and thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. So in other words, I'm a survivor. Yes. Then she went on to say, I kept thinking I could never live without you by my side. Now, I guess I'm here to let you know that I love my mother. I love my children. Yes. And I love my wife over there. But if for some reason they decide that they don't want to be bothered with me no more, they decide they want to walk away and leave me, yes, on the natural side, I will be hurt. I may be sad from time to time. But I assure you, at some way, I will figure out a way to keep moving. And I will figure out a way to keep walking this walk of life. But I'm here to let you know that there is absolutely, positively no way that I can live without Jesus in my life. I said, there is no way that I can live without Jesus in my life. Romans 8:10 says, if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, yet the spirit is alive because of righteousness. So in other words, through Jesus Christ, I'm a survivor. Because even though I may die, if I die in Christ, I am still going to live again. Amen. I'm a survivor. Then I believe she went on to say, but then I spent so many nights thinking how you did me wrong. Ain't that how some of us do? You spent so many nights thinking how he or she did me wrong. And then I grew strong and I learned how to get along. Well, once again, Sister Gloria had the right idea, but she was just singing about the wrong person. Because you see, if she knew the God that I serve and the God that you serve, that she would have already known that our strength comes from Jesus Christ. And only through Jesus Christ. It don't come from nobody else, but our strength that I have comes from Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 9 and 10 says, "And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take no pleasure in my infirmities, in my reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses, for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong. For when I am weak, then I am strong." So in other words, with Jesus Christ, I'm a survivor. Yes. Now, so as I get ready to take my seat, amen. I know a lot of times preachers, they take their seat about four or five times, but that's not going to be me on this morning. When I say I'm going to take my seat, I'm going to take my seat. But as I get ready to take my seat, some of you may be wondering, how can I become a survivor? How can I become a survivor? Well, the answer is simple. You see, survival is a mindset. I said survival is a mindset. And when I think about mindset, my mind runs back to one of the, I guess, greatest basketball players, God rest his soul, Kobe Bryant, the Black Mamba. And he said that he had that Mamba mindset. When he was on that court, he felt that he was the greatest, the best, and there was no one that could stop him. It was a mindset. Now, that didn't mean that no one could stop him, but in his mind, he knew or he felt that no one could stop him. And that's just like what we have to do even with the survival. We have to believe in our mind that no matter what comes our way, we are going to make it. You see, the devil knows that if he wants to get us off track, all he has to do is attack our minds. I said, and I think we broke that out on Wednesday night as well. I said, the devil knows if he just gets to our mind. I think our brother preacher here, when we brought up, when we was talking about the garden and how Eve was looking at that tree. So it was already playing in her mind. And the devil knew it. So when he came her way, he didn't really have a whole lot to do to convince her, because she had already kind of already made up in her mind that she was going to taste of this tree, no matter what. Amen. So the devil knows that all he has to do is attack our minds. That's why it is important that we keep our hearts and our minds on Jesus Christ. So when Satan tells you that you can't, you can declare and stand that through Jesus Christ, you can. So when Satan tells you to throw in the towel, it's over, you can stand and declare that with Jesus Christ, nothing is impossible. So if you really want to have a survival mentality, all you really have to do is have faith. I said, all you have to do is have faith and believe. You see, Hebrews 11:1 says, "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen." I said, now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. So in other words, you may be looking at defeat right now, but you have to see victory. I said, you may be looking at defeat right now, but you have to see victory. You see, you may be looking at sickness unto death in your body right now, but you have to see total healing through the blood of Jesus. You see, you may be looking at a marriage that is falling apart, but you have to see total restoration in your marriage through Jesus Christ. You see, I'm reminded of that old train that could. And we all heard the story about how the train was approaching the hill. And as the train saw the hill, see, the train was already defeated mentally already. Because when the train saw that hill, the train immediately started to say, "I can't. I can't. I can't. There's no way. I can't." But then the train began to go up the hill. And the train was going slow at first. It was going very slow. And then the train started to say, "I think I can. I think I can. I think I can." And the train kept going up the hill. I'm pretty sure that the enemy was in that train's mind saying, no, you can't, just stop. Back, back, it's easier to back, back now. How many of you know that it's easier to go back? It's much easier to turn around and go the other way, but that's not what God wants us to do. He wants us to continue to push forward, trusting in Him. And so as that train approached the top of the hill, the train began to say, I know I can. I know I can. I know I can. And the closer the train got to the top of the hill, the faster it began to move. And then we all know that once the train went over the hill, the train began to say, I knew I can. I knew I can. I knew I can. And you see, so what am I saying? It's time for us to know that no matter what we are going through in our life, no matter how much the enemy may try to tell us that we're defeated, we have to know that we have the victory and that we will survive. When our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ picked up that cross over 2,000 years ago, I'm sure that the enemy was trying to get him to put that cross down. I'm sure the enemy was trying to get him to just say, don't worry about those people because they are hard-headed anyway. They're the reason why you're up here. Amen. But I am so glad that Jesus had that survival mentality. And Jesus continued to carry that old rugged cross. And as he was being called all types of names, he was being beat, he was being spit on, he was being persecuted for no reason at all. But Jesus still kept pushing on. Why? Because he had that survival mentality. And once again, as he was hanging on that old rugged cross, I'm sure that the enemy told him, listen, you're Jesus. You're supposed to be the Son of God. Why don't you come down off that old cross and save yourself? But once again, Jesus being who he is, because he loved us so much that he chose to stay on that cross. And after hanging on that cross, we all know that he gave up the ghost. I always like to point out that no one killed Jesus, but he gave up his life just for you and me. And then after Jesus was placed in that borrowed tomb, and it seemed like all hope was gone. It seemed like death had won. But we all know that early Sunday morning, on that third day, Jesus got up out the grave. And he got up out that grave with all power. And he got up out that grave giving us the gift of salvation. And giving us the right to eternal life. Giving us the ability to stand and declare that I'm a survivor. So all we have to do is just keep the faith and trust and believe that our God will bring us through whatever we are dealing with. Romans 10 and 9 says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth that the Lord Jesus and believe in our heart that God has raised him from the dead, then we shall be saved. So it doesn't matter what you're going through. It doesn't matter how long you've been going through. All you have to know is that I will trust in God with all my heart. The man writer wrote the words and said, I trust in God. Wherever I may be, on the land or on the rolling sea, for come what may, from day to day, my heavenly Father, he watches over me. And because I know he's watching over me, you ought to be happy to know that he's watching over you too. And the songwriter said that his in God's sight. But we have to know that we are blessed by through his grace and through his mercy that will bring us this far. Yeah. The God that we serve, we know that he never sleeps and we know that he never slumbers. But all we have to do is just continue to look to him for what's coming for our help, knowing that our help is from the Lord. So once again, when the enemy tells you that you can't win, you have to stand and declare, I'm a winner. I'm a survivor. I'm going to live on. Why? Because I've learned that if I would trust in the Lord with all my heart, and I lean not and through my own understanding. But I want to make sure that you get the message that I'm a survivor.
Yeah.
I'm a survivor. Because see, it'd be good when us just running and dancing, but if we run and dancing, we really haven't put that in our heart, we're going to run and dance out of here and still fall down on our face. Because we don't believe what the Word of God has let us know. So there may be someone right here in this house today that may not know who Jesus Christ is. They may not believe that they can survive. And I'm sure, like I've already said, I know the enemy is always trying to discourage us. He is always trying to make us think that we can't make it. But God sent me here today just to say that you are a survivor. And we can make it. Amen. So if there's someone here, we're going to open up the doors of the church. If there's someone here right now, and you don't know who Jesus is, now is the time. I know we open up the doors of the church. You may be looking for a church home, and that's a wonderful thing as well. But I'm more concerned about your soul. You know, membership is really, that's one thing, but it's all about being a member of the body of Christ. Amen. Because that's the only way that you will really be able to stand and declare that you are a survivor in these last and evil days. So if that is you and you are looking and you have a need in your life, please don't hesitate. Don't hold on to the seat, but come on down. Amen.
I love you, Jesus.
Come on, help me sing that song. A very simple song. I worship. Because we know
things, oh God, we won't fail to give you the honor, the glory, and the praise, because we know that